Okay, good. Just give me feedback if I talk too fast or if there's anything. So I will talk about signature types for type-correct collective operations revisited. And revisited means there have been some previous papers also using signature types. So by Joachim Protze, who's also here at this conference, I think, and myself. And so it's more about this. So this is all about how to do type-safe communication in MPI, in particular in collective operations. So this is perhaps interesting both to MPI implementers, but also to people who build libraries with some kind of collective communication operations. And I will tell you what I mean. So let's start here with a warning. So if you program like this, so you see here, there's a sending process that wants to send 10 ints, and it sends it with an MPI int. So it gives these ints the correct MPI type. And then at the receiving type, at the receiving side, these ints are received as bytes. And this is erroneous according to the MPI standard. The problem is that the type information is lost. And on the receiving side, the receiver cannot really know what to do with these bytes. So if you program like this, the rest of this talk is irrelevant. And probably many people do program like this. And if your system is homogeneous, this may not be such a big deal. But according to MPI, the spirit of MPI, this is not the correct way. Okay, there are also some subtleties here. But so this is something which I think is correct according to the MPI standard. So here we have our 10 ints, but we send them as bytes, and we also receive them as bytes. Again, here, of course, the type information is lost, but I think this is correct. But again, this is not the way that you should program. And here's the correct way to do it in MPI. You send something and your ints as MPI ints, and you receive them on the other side also as MPI ints. And this, of course, goes for all structured data. So if you use complex data types described via the MPI-derived data types, this can, of course, be more complex. But the idea with MPI is that the type that you give on the sending side must match what you are prepared to receive on the receiving side. And this is a correct way to program. And that is what we want to support with these signature types. So what is a signature type? This is a derived data type which describes the basic elements in a stream of data. And here we are particularly interested in signature types that can be used in collective operations. So the two issues in this paper here is, in particular for collective operations, do such signature types exist consistently across processes? So can processes independently of each other compute a signature type that can then be used correctly for the communication? And the next issue is how can we compute such signature types efficiently? How fast can we do it? Are there any obstacles to this? So the whole thing is about how to do type-safe communication in collective operations. So here's an example. Some process has non-contiguous data. So we see these yellow, green, blue blobs. These are different basic data types, and they are not contiguous in memory, and they are described via a derived data type. And then we communicate. And the other process wants to store these data intermediate in an intermediately, maybe because they are going to be sent somewhere else later. And of course, for such intermediate storage, we don't want to waste space. So we don't want to have the same data type as the sending process where things are not contiguous. We want to have a consecutive data type. And this must have the same type signature as what is being sent. So the sequence of yellow, green, blue must be exactly as way things are being sent by the sending process. So this small thing, the first yellow, green, blue is the signature type that we want to compute. And with this signature type, we can allocate space for intermediate buffers, and we can receive data correctly into these intermediate buffers. So this is what we are after. So a signature type is a short, or even the shortest possible, derived contiguous MPI data type that describes the type signature of a stream of data. So here we see MPI sent, and then there's a count and a data type argument that describes what is in the memory, and this then go out on the line as a stream of typed elements, and the process receiving on the other side must specify something which has the same signature, so the same sequence of typed elements. And here are some references, what I mentioned, where these signature types have been used explicitly, and there are some ideas of how to compute them. So this talk is about more on how to compute signature types. Why is this not so trivial? The problem here, especially in collective operations, is that all the processes might give different count and data type arguments. The only requirement is that two processes that are related, so that means there is somehow a communication specified between these two processes, must specify exactly the same sequences of basic elements, but each process may do it in a different way, so they can use different count and data type elements. So here my example is that we implement the bcast operation as first a scatter operation, and then followed by an all-gather operation. You all know this way of implementing broadcast. And here, of course, the problem is for each process, what is the right count? What is the right block size to use? How can we be sure that when one process computes a count and a data type, that this matches what the other processes are doing? So here, again, for broadcast, so here we do an MPI broadcast, 12,000 ints. Maybe the root says it like this, and then the other process, some other process, okay, I'm prepared to receive 6,000 elements of something which is described by a derived data type that contains two ints. And another process says, okay, I will only receive 400 elements, and these elements consist of 30 times some int described by some weird derived data types. And another one says, okay, I receive 30 elements, but this is in a big derived data type, and so on and so forth. And how can these processes agree that now we use the same or a consistent signature type? So this is a problem. And here's another example. So when we have used tree algorithms, maybe for something like a gather B operation, we might have an algorithm which tries to build a tree, and in this tree we want to do the communication in a type correct manner. So all the processes here have a send type in the gather V, and only the root knows everything. So the root has a receive type for all the processes and knows the counts for all the non-root processes. So what can the intermediate processes do in the tree? So here one is in the example. So one process sends uses a derived data type. So the yellow, the green, and the blue thing spaced somehow in memory. The other process has it spaced differently, also the yellow, the green, and the blue, but now in different positions, whatever. So they have different send types. But of course, the signatures of these send types must match what the root eventually is going to receive. And we see that the intermediate process here is using a signature type to receive these blocks from the leaf processes and combine that into a big message that will eventually go up the tree. And here the third leaf process has another big data type, and this goes to the is sent as the stream of basic elements up to the intermediate process. So there are different problems here. So the weird thing with this gather V collective is that only the root has full information. The intermediate processes or the non-root processes do not know anything about the other processes. So how many elements are they going to send, and what is the type of these elements? They only know something about the root and about themselves. And as we saw here in the example, the send types of the different processes might be different. And here another small problem is that same types are allowed here to have overlapping entries. So that means we cannot use the same type that a process has as the receive type for these intermediate buffer, because that there might be overlapping entries. So there are some problems here. How can we guarantee, and how can we compute a correct signature type in this case? This is a small one here. So what we want, so the green and the blue in a consecutive way. This is a signature type that we want. And how can we make sure that when one process computes this, then it will match what all other processes are computing? So do these types exist, and how can we find them? And in the paper, there are various other use cases. So obviously, when we do pipeline algorithms, we can have these problems. And when we do message combining algorithms, where some process is receiving data from many processes and then eventually sending them further on to some other processes, we want these signature types to store these combined messages. So there are many applications, and this is not only for MBI implementers, also application specific libraries might specify kind of collective operations or operations where you operate on type data, and they could use these signature types. Okay, so here comes the positive contribution of this paper, namely the claim that consistent signature types exist if you have operations with collective semantics. So here are some definitions. So we say that an function has collective data semantics if the number of elements, so the count and the basic data types that are going to be sent match exactly what the other process is going to receive. So the same sequence of basic elements, same counts. Of course, all the processes can use different data types for describing this, but the streams that are sort of being communicated must match exactly. So that is what we mean by collective semantics. And this is a requirement which is posed in MPI for all collective operations, that related processes specify exactly the same number of elements and the same basic data types in the same order. Yeah. So the signature of a stream of communicated elements is just a string of basic data types. So like here in the example, MPI int, MPI int, MPI double, MPI int, dot, 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 whatever. So this is what is sort of semantically out on the line. This is signature, so this is, we just think of the signature as a string. And then the important thing here is this concept from stringology. The period of a string is the shortest prefix r of the string, such that when we repeat this r sufficiently many times, then we get the full string s. And now the surprise will not be great that these prefixes is exactly what we need to compute to compute consistent signature types. Okay, so remember this: the period of a string. And here is now the positive contribution. So this proposition. So if we have two processes I and j that are related, that means some communication between I and j is specified in the collective operation, and ci and ti are the counts and types for process I, and cj and ctj are the counts and data types for process j. Then we find the periods of the two strings that go out on the line. So this is the data type ti repeated ci times, and the data type tj repeated cj times. We find the periods in both of these strings. The processes can do this independent of each other. These prefixes, these periods are I and rj, are then identical. And that means that the periods that the process can compute locally just based on the derived data type and the count that it has can be used as the signature type. Okay, so periods are unique and consistent if you have collective semantics. And so finding the signature type then boils down to finding periods in strings of basic data types. Yeah? And this computation can be done locally. No communication of type meta information is needed. And this is a strong point of why this requirement is so important in collective operations, these collective semantics. So why is this so? So here's a sketch of the proof. So we do this by a picture here and by contradiction. So we assume that the two periods Ri and Rj that the processes have computed are actually different. Then we look at the prefix of length. We take the greatest common divisor of the prefix Ri and the prefix Rj. And then we can show that this prefix is actually a period for both the strings. And this contradicts us that either Ri or Rj were shortest. So contradicts the definition of being a period either for process I or for process J. So here the picture shows what's going on. So we have the two processes I and J. They have specified what's going to be sent. So the string Ti repeated Ci times and the string Tj repeated Tj times. And by the requirement, these two strings are identical. And then we look at the greatest common divisor. This is this blue square at the beginning. And then Ti consists of this prefix, the blue prefix, and there's maybe a yellow block of the same size and a green block, an orange block of the same size. And what we want to prove is that the blue, the yellow and the orange thing are actually the same. Yeah. This is a claim here that the blue thing is actually a prefix of both the string for process I and the string for process J, and that is then the contradiction. So let's look at the yellow block and see that this is actually identical to the blue block. So here it is. Because the two strings are identical, the yellow block is also at the string for process J. And since we have a prefix Rj, the period Rj is a prefix of the string for process J, this is repeated. So the yellow thing also is here, and it's also here in the last block. And now we see that this yellow block is actually at the beginning of the period, so the repeated period of the string for process I. So in the first place, so here we see that actually the yellow one is equal to the blue one. So that was what we wanted to prove, and this follows in general by some theorem from number theory, which says that if you take this greatest common divisor of the two periods, then there exists X and Y's, such that when we look at the case block, so the case here is exactly the yellow thing. And when we look at this one, so for any K, so also the orange one, then we can just shift them so that this is at the beginning of the period of process, what process J has computed. So that sort of proves, or that actually proves what we were after. So this shows a contradiction that these periods that both processes can compute independent of each other are actually the same, and then we can use the period for as a signature type. Okay, how do we do this? Then you think about that, finding periods, and then you dig out your own algorithms books and discover the Knuth-Morris-Pratt pattern matching algorithm, for instance, does exactly that. So the pre-processing step in the KMP algorithm actually amounts to finding the period. Or you can look in the internet and you will find such things, and you can also see it in the paper. So here we now have a constructive thing. We can compute the signature types in linear time in the size of the signature string. Okay, so this is good, sounds good, linear time. We will return to this. So here again, to stress, the important thing is these collective semantics. So this is a strong and very useful requirement, and people designing libraries with collective operations should maybe think of this. Also, this works. These signatures exist for the rooted algorithm. So here, the corollary says that if two processes I and J are both related to some root process, then they can both compute the periods, and these periods will then be the same. And this follows easily from this proposition just by transitivity. So we can do a type correct implementation of gather V by these observations. So this is fine. Here's a negative observation. All to all V, all to all W. So where each message may have its own type, for this we can actually not do a type safe implementation without communicating type meta information. And why is this? Okay, so I should say a type correct message combining implementation. So it is, we cannot do an implementation where when process I needs to send some data to a process J, it does that via some intermediate process K. And the thing is that I and J are not related to K. So the type information that process K has is useless for doing, for computing a signature type that can be used for the data that process I and process J send between each other. Yeah, exactly because of this, there's no common root in quotation marks, which guarantees the existence of a signature type. So this is perhaps bad news. Good news is, as we just heard from Martin, persistent will come into MPI 4.0, and persistent also all W, we could at any time exchange the signature, sorry, the type meta information where this is needed, and we can do type correct message combining implementations also of the auto W collective, which is actually a very useful collective operation. Okay, so I have to be careful with my time. Is this good enough? So this is our second question. So what we actually do want, the user specifies the type maps by constructing these by the derived data types. And what we of course want to be able to do is to compute the signature type directly and efficiently from the specification that the user, from that the application programmer has given. Yeah. And now the problem is that so we can think of the derived data types as a kind of tree or a DAG or these MPI type constructors. And the problem here is that the type signature or the type map that is described by a derived data type tree can be arbitrarily larger than the size of the tree. And this is because of these counts that we have with the MPI constructors. We can repeat things many times, and this means that the string which is described by a type tree can be much, much larger than the type. So therefore, linear type in the size of the string might not be good enough. And this is an interesting problem and a difficult problem. So also desire two, what our definition of signature type said that we want the shortest possible description or representation of the signature type. And also this is a difficult problem. So we had some papers some years ago where we tried from the string to construct smallest possible type trees describing this string, and this could be done in polynomial time, but with so s to the fourth, which is horrible. So if the string is moderately large, this is very, very complex. And that's not what we want. So here's certainly something to be done. And this seems to be a difficult problem. So going to the first problem, finding periods and strings directly from some compact representation, like a tree or something else, is a difficult problem. So the best thing I know is via straight line programs. Maybe I'm running out of time. So I don't know if you know this, I didn't really know it. Straight line programs is a kind of grammar for a compact way of describing strings, similar to a tree. So we could describe type trees fire straight line programs. This is easy. There's only a logarithmic blow up. And then there are some results on straight line programs that says that you can actually find periods in time, which is much better than linear in the size of the string. I have not implemented these things. And this is also not exactly what we want, but it seems that these are results that are out there and people are thinking about this and these are interesting problems. So, okay. So, can we do better? So what do we do? We have a library for data type programming. I presented this at Euro MPI some years ago. And there was also something about signature type. So this is an improvement to this library. So there are two cases. Most derived data types are actually homogeneous. So they are all the same basic data type. And in that case, there's no problem. We just have to discover that it is homogeneous and then we can directly compute. Then we immediately have the signature type. And if that is not the case, then we use the structure of the type of the data type tree that the user has provided to find a representation of the period, which is no bigger than what the user has already given us. Okay, so here's just an indication how this works. So we go to the data type, expand the signature, do the computation of the period by the KMP algorithm, and then we again go to the type tree and just pick out the part of the type tree that we need to describe exactly the period string. So that's it. And okay, that is the best that we have, and that sort of concludes my talk. I just want to mention that in MPI as it is now, the support for doing things with data types is very weak. There's not even a function for querying whether a data type is homogeneous, whereas the IS elements, I think this decoding functionality is quite terrible to work with. And signature types might, as pre-computed attributes to data types, might actually be something which could be helpful to library builders. Okay, thanks. I hope this was understandable and that was not too long.
Thank you, Jesper. Any questions? Let's see. None on the Slack channel. So very quickly, I had one question. Can you please comment a little bit more on how we can use signatures and beyond maybe safety checks? Can we do any optimizations with them?
Optimization. So in the sense of saving space, if you store some data from another process, you of course don't want to use a non-contiguous layout. You want to store it compactly. So for that kind of optimization, they are useful. But this is more about correctness. There's no immediate benefit in running times. That is not the point here. Mm-hmm. It's about how to do type safe and type correct implementation for MPI functions and also on top of MPI.
And is the problem of finding the minimal period absolutely critical? What if we find a period that is not necessarily the shortest one?
No, you need the shortest one. Otherwise, you don't have the consistency. You need to be sure that processes compute exactly the same thing. Therefore, you have to agree on the minimal one. So you need to find the period. So per definition, the period is the shortest repeated prefix. And that you need to find. Otherwise it breaks down. And if you don't have this collective requirement that processes send the same number of elements, then also it breaks down. So this does not work for point-to-point communication. Yeah, you can't do these things.
Thank you, Jesper.
Okay.